You say the Democratic Party is looking to replace the current electorate with people from the third world who you deem, quote, more obedient.
Yeah.
Given that the people of Nicaragua, El Salvador, Guatemala, and Honduras, and many other places have fought bloody wars over politics recently, what makes you believe they'd be more obedient voters?
Well, actually, that's such a great question. I would just two parts. One, the only purpose of Biden's immigration policy is to change the electorate to make it more likely that Democrats dominate. There's no other justification for it. The more you look at, they say this out loud. This is not a conspiracy theory. It's something the Democratic Party brags about and has for years. Changing demographics will make this country more democratic. They say that. Their books have been written about it. They're not ashamed of it. I'm just saying what they say, and it's true. But your question is a deep and smart question. Will these voters actually long-term be Democratic voters? Will they do what the academic white liberals who run the Democratic Party want them to do long-term? And actually, I think the answer is no. I think you're right. I think they have no idea who these people are and what they're actually like. So what we're doing is importing a lot of people from the third world who live, and I wish I could think of a different phrase than the third world because it sounds pejorative, I don't mean it that way, but from poorer countries who have far more traditional family structures and far more traditional and conservative attitudes than our leadership has. So like I was talking to a friend of mine the other day whose parents came from Oaxaca, Mexico as laborers. So, you know, this hit Latino, I guess would be the term for this guy. And he said to me the other day, he goes, the funny thing is that white liberals import all these people and then immediately call them Latinx or whatever. Why do they do that? Because they are trying to make Latin culture less patriarchal. The Spanish language is a gendered language for a reason. It reflects the culture of Spanish-speaking countries. But white liberals bring these people in and imagine that they're all going to be like Oberlin graduates, you know, living in Brooklyn, you know, and drinking artisanal coffee. Actually, no, not at all. So I think long term, and you see it in the voting patterns, by the way, in Texas, a lot of self-identified Hispanics are enraged by Biden's border policies. Like they're not into this at all. They're not liberal.
So why is it that Republicans want to stop immigration in that case? And why are they so nervous about it? Why don't they think they can challenge for those votes? Wouldn't that be an advantage? Because as we know, demographically, the Republican demographic, the strong Republican demographic is getting older. They're having fewer children. We see that, of course, white people are becoming a smaller group in the United States. So wouldn't Republicans benefit from immigration? I mean, why aren't they the ones that are pushing for it?
Well, they might. They might. I mean, I can only speak for myself.
Doesn't sound like it.
And not the morons who run the Republican Party. Well, they are pushing for it because they are mostly tools of the business lobby, of the business roundtable in the Chamber of Commerce, and have been for generations. So they do whatever their corporate masters tell them to do. I'm looking at it from a different perspective, and I'm against it for three reasons. One, it loosens the labor market in a way that lowers wages. If you have more willing workers, they get paid less. It's super simple. It's
the Bernie Sanders, opposition.
Of course.
To illegal immigration.
It's really a traditionally left-wing, labor-oriented point of view, but it's just true. Yeah. It's just like economics 101. That's the first reason. The second reason is because it is an attack on democracy. You can't pack the electorate just because you don't like an election outcome. The rule is for all Americans, regardless of their color or ancestry, that one man, one vote. We all have a say in who runs our country. We're in charge of our system. It's called representative democracy, right? That's the whole bargain that we make with our government. But the second you decide, well, I don't really like how you voted, I'm going to bring in new people. You devalue my vote and your vote, Jason Nichols, and your vote, Vince Colonies. You basically water down the political power of American citizens. That's worse than any Russian hacking. That's the second reason. Third reason is just a really simple reason that like wise people understand immediately. This country's too freaking volatile. That our society is coming apart. It's the country has no unifying belief. There's nothing that the majority of Americans have in common anymore. And it's super important that we do, or else the country will literally break apart. That's just That's the nature of countries. They don't hold together by accident or because they have a common flag. There has to be a common belief. And this endless churn of new people who don't speak the language, who don't understand the traditions, the history, the culture, the
but Tucker, hold
it
on,
makes you crazy.
But Tucker, you just said that a lot of these people have traditional conservative views, right?
Yeah,
you know, a lot of people from Latin America are Catholic. You know, 55% of Haitians are Roman Catholic.
Exactly.
You know, you have that. So if they have those values, why you just again said that they don't have the same values that we have? That's what I'm trying to figure out is
you're missing it. And I'm not. So every time I say this, first of all, they want to say it's some sort of conspiracy theory. Again, I'm just repeating what they've already said and are continuing to say. Washington Post columnist said it last week. So I'm just taking their talking points and explaining what they mean.
Sure.
And I'm not attacking the immigrants. By the way, if I was living in Haiti or Salvador or Managua and someone said, I will give you free health care if you come to my country and the door's open, dude, I'd be on the next train. I mean it. So I totally sympathize with them. I don't blame them. I would do the same thing for my family. I think a lot of them have views that are much closer to mine than Kamala Harris's, for sure. So it's not about attacking them. I don't feel animus toward them at all. I'm saying there is a shared culture that develops when people live together, even in a continental country the size of ours, over centuries, that gives the country cohesion. If you have brand new people showing up, if you've got children at home, if all of a sudden somebody said, hey, Jason Nichols, you know, you're a pretty famous guy, you make a decent living, you should help the world's children. Here are six more children who are gonna be living in your house. They'd be great children. You'd be doing a good thing by helping them. There's nothing immoral about any of that. But what would the effect on your own children be? They'd be like, I don't get to see my dad. It would be a chaotic scene at your breakfast table. Trust me, you know that, I know that. The countries are not so different. If you import a million new people a month who don't speak your language, who have no understanding of your culture, no shared history with the people who already live here, dude, your country's going to get super chaotic. I mean, we went through this 100 years ago. That's why we put an immigration moratorium on the 1920s, like a cooling down period. Let's calm down. We're all Americans. We're closing the borders. Doesn't matter if you're Italian or Greek or Polish Jewish. You know, we're all in this together now. Let's rediscover what unites us. We need a moment like that right now.